The chair recognizes Senator Johnson.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to start off by just thanking our law enforcement witnesses for your service. I know there's 2020 is hindsight. It's pretty easy to Monday morning quarterback, and I want to make sure that we guard against doing so. Certainly what I've seen from testimony, it seems like there's a fair amount of thought, a fair amount of due diligence that went into this. So again, I appreciate your service. I also want to say I find the videos, as you said, Chief Sund, sickening. The violence, reprehensible. The racial slurs, repugnant. And I want to make sure the perpetrators, the people that engage in the violence, are prosecuted the full extent of the law. I've got a long list of questions, which this format really doesn't lend itself to asking. So what I will be doing is preparing a letter for the committee chair and hoping that they will ask those questions and investigate these issues that I'll be listing. But what I want to do is, in terms of asking some questions, I want to start out by reading excerpts from what I thought was a very interesting eyewitness account by J. Michael Waller. He is a senior analyst for a strategy at the Center of Security Policy. His areas of concentration include political and psychological warfare and subversion. He's a former professor and instructor at the Institute of World Politics at the Naval Postgraduate School. He's a current lecturer at the John F. Kennedy School Special Warfare Center at Fort Bragg. He wrote this piece titled, "I Saw Provocateurs at the Capitol Riot on January 6th. And he basically arrived on scene by 11:30 from Union Station. And I'll just start reading. "And by 11:30, I walked from near Union Station and noticed a small number of Capitol Police dressed in full riot gear with shin guards and shoulder guards. Then I walked up Pennsylvania Avenue toward an empty Freedom Park. He noticed that the speech had broken up, and so a crowd was walking down Constitution Avenue. He joined them at 13th Street. But he said the mood of the crowd was positive and festive. Of the thousands of people I passed or who passed me along Constitution Avenue, some were indignant and contemptuous of Congress, but not one appeared angry or incited to riot. Many of the marchers were families with small children. Many were elderly, overweight, or just plain tired or frail, traits not typically attributed to the riot prone. Many wore pro-police shirts or carried pro-police black and blue flags. Although the crowd represented a broad cross-section of Americans, mostly working class by their appearance and manner of speech, some people stood out. A very few didn't share the jovial, friendly, earnest demeanor of the great majority. Some obviously didn't fit in." And he describes four different types of people: plainclothes militants, agents provocateurs, fake Trump protesters, and then disciplined, uniformed column of attackers. I think these are the people that probably planned this. He goes on, "The D.C. Metropolitan Police were their usual professionally detached selves, standing on curbs or at street crossings and exchanging an occasional greeting from marchers. When we crossed First Street Northwest to enter the Capitol grounds where the Capitol Police had jurisdiction, I noticed no police at all. Several marchers expressed surprise. The openness seemed like a courtesy gesture from Congress, which controls security. That appearance of low threat level made no sense. Yet no Capitol Police appeared anywhere from what we could see." Now, again, I'm taking these excerpts in order, but there's a lot more to this piece. "What looked like tens or even hundreds of thousands of people surged down the avenues as far as one can see, but almost everyone seemed talkative and happy. No police could be seen on the platform for now. No police could be seen anywhere. People kept surging in from Constitutional Avenue, and the plaza quickly filled up and overflowed onto the lawn. Everyone squeezed closer and closer together, with most in high spirits. Some trouble began up in the front, near the base of the inaugural platform itself, but we could not see what was happening. Then something happened at the front of the crowd. It seemed like a scuffle, but from 40 feet back, I couldn't see. People started chanting, 'USA, USA,' and other slogans. For a few seconds, I saw what looked like police in a tussle with some of the marchers up front, what appeared to be an organized group in civilian clothes. This organized group are the cell I would call the plainclothes militants. They fit right in with MAGA people. Suddenly, energy surged from the front of the crowd as the anti-riot police, above on the inaugural platform, visibly tensed up. One fired a tear gas canister, not at the plainclothes militants in the front line, but into the crowd itself. Then another. Flash grenades went off in the middle of the crowd. The tear gas changed the crowd's demeanor. There was an air of disbelief as people realized that the police whom they supported were firing on them. 'What are you doing? We support you,' someone yelled. All of a sudden, pro-police people felt the police were attacking them, and they didn't know why. More tear gas. A canister struck a girl in the face, drawing blood. The pro-police crowd went from disbelief and confusion to anger. I'll stop there. The last five pages is titled, Provocateurs Turn Unsuspecting Marchers into an Invading Mob. So I'd really recommend everybody in the committee read this account, and I've asked that it be entered into the record. But Chief Sutt, I want to ask you, is one of the House managers made a big deal that this was predictable, this was foreseeable, which I don't believe. Do you believe that what happened, the breach of the Capitol, did you believe that's foreseeable and predictable?
No, I don't, nor do, if you look at some of our other partner agencies, I think Acting Chief Conte actually made the statement that the breach of the Capitol was not something anybody anticipated, nor do I think some of our federal partners expected it. I don't think Secret Service would have brought up the vice president if they expected it.
Is part of that because of what you'd experienced in the past, what this Mr. Waller experiences? The vast majority of Trump supporters are pro-law enforcement, and the last thing they would do is violate the law?
I will say that information I've received from some of my officers were they were trying to prevent people from coming into the building, and people were showing up saying, hey, we're police, let us through, and still wanting to violate the law to get inside the building. So, you know.
Again, I've got a long, long list. I just want to close with the two former sergeant of arms. I knew these committees were going to start an investigation. I waited a couple weeks. I didn't see any letter go out, oversight letter, so I wrote my own on the 21st. And I just have a question for both the former sergeant of arms. Did you get my letter, my oversight letter, with my questions?
I did not. I did not receive your letter. I left town right after I resigned. But I certainly look forward to working with you and your staff to answer your questions.
Okay, well, if you could give us an address, because we sent it to the acting sergeant of arms. That acting sergeant of arms won't even let us know whether they passed that letter along to you. Apparently they didn't. Mr. Stanger, did you receive my letter?
I don't recall it, Senator, but it might have come, but I don't recall.
Chief Sun, one last question for you. Do you regret resigning?
Yes, I do, sir. I certainly do regret resigning. I love this agency. I love the women and men of this agency, and I regret the day I left.
Well, Mr. Irving, Mr. Stanger, I really wish you'd respond. You know, first of all, look for my letter, and I'd like an answer to that as quickly as possible. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Johnson.